probably answer quite a few questions from Lawton, people that have already been in the training that I did with the tech specialist. And when they don't know something, they email me. And as long as you're patient with me and responding back, then usually I get that back to you. So I have put pretty much everything in this document that you can think of about Google Apps, Google Suite, Google Classroom, Google Forms, Google Calendar. Might not be a lot of calendar, but I'll definitely show you calendar. So how many of you are already using G Suite or Google Apps? You're already using the Google tools that you have access to here.
Using proficiently? Or
just using. Proficient, where you can just take off the tab table. If you're using, that's good. Are
have
any,
used.
You
not
what?
U- have used. Ha- not
have
using.
Used, but not using.
Right.
Okay. Good. So hopefully you'll know a little bit more when you leave here so you can use it more proficiently, or you can go back to those tools and use them, especially with Chromebooks coming out in your district. It will be very helpful if you start using the tools themselves. So the first thing let's talk about is a common vocabulary. So what does it mean? Because some people will say Google Docs and they really mean Google Sheets, or they might say Google Drive and they mean everything. So this is just a little bit of a common vocabulary. So until, I don't know, maybe this summer, it used to be called GAFE, or some people called it GAFE, or some people called it GAFE, or whatever, but it was G-A-F-E, and it stood for Google Apps for Education. Well, then they did a name change, and now they call it G Suite, which I don't like the name, but they didn't really ask me.
No.
I like the idea of suite, because it is a suite of applications, just like the Microsoft suite of applications. Google has their own suite of applications. So that part I like, but the other part, I don't know, it seems weird. So when we talk about Google Drive, that's just like if you took a flash drive and you stuck it in the side of your computer and it has all of your files and things on it. Google Drive is a flash drive in the sky, basically. It's your place where you store all of your stuff. So all of your files you've created, all of the files that people might share with you will be stored in your Google Drive. The good thing about Google Apps is it does not cost your district anything. It is free for us in education. And it is unlimited storage. So if you have a personal Gmail account or you have a personal Google Drive account, you probably have about 15 gigs of storage. Maybe 30, depending upon if you bought new devices and have gotten extra storage that way, or you can pay for extra. But with your school account, it's unlimited storage. So all of those videos that your kids make and take, or all the pictures that you have taken, you can store them in your Google Drive without it costing the district one penny. And it's unlimited. You don't have to worry about, oh, I got to take stuff out so more stuff can fit. All right, then we have Google Docs, which this document is created in a Google Doc. So you see the blue with the lines in the top left-hand corner? That lets me know I'm in a Google document. And it's just like Microsoft Word. Okay? The only difference is instead of being stored on our physical computers, it's stored in the cloud. So it's stored on Google servers instead of Lawton servers. But very, very similar to Microsoft Word. And the nice thing about your Google Apps is when they update, you don't have to worry about, well, when's the next update coming, and I'm going to have to pay to upgrade from Office 2008 to 2010 or whatever. Google updates their G Suite, at least, I can't remember, I heard one of the Google reps recently say it, but it's something like 360 times a year there's an update of some kind to one of their G Suite products. So it's constantly updating. So if a new feature rolls out in Google Docs, we get it right away. Or depending upon what we set in the admin console for the people who manage your Google Docs, it could come out in 2 weeks. But that once it's out in 2 weeks, you will at least have it. Okay, so you're not having to wait till next year or have to buy something new. Google Sheets is very similar to Microsoft Excel. Okay, and even the same colors that Microsoft uses for its applications, you know, the W for Microsoft Word is blue, Google Docs is blue. The Excel is green, Google Sheets is green, PowerPoint is orange, Google Slides is orange. Okay, so it kind of helps you to know which is which. And then Google Slides we have is very similar to PowerPoint. Okay. One thing we don't have that's listed there between Sheets and Slides, in Microsoft Office, we don't have the capability of a whole new program creating a form. You can create forms within Word, but you cannot create just a own separate little form, like a survey that we can take. And so it's really, really helpful tool. And now built into that is the ability for you to give quizzes on a Google form and it automatically be graded for you. So who doesn't like that? Because it's taking a little bit of work off of our shoulders. So that's Google Forms, and I'll show you what all these look like. Then we have Google Classroom, which is really your online classroom. So it's a place where you can post assignments, you can post announcements, you can post your syllabus, you can post files and things that you have, and then students access that from anywhere. So with their Chromebooks, I can't remember, do your kids take Chromebooks home or they stay in school? They stay in school. But it would not really matter if they go home, as long as they can get on any device, they can get to Google Classroom. So they could put it on their phone, they can put it on a tablet, they can get it from a desktop. If they have Chromebook, that's what my boys have, they have Chromebooks, they access Google Classroom from anywhere they have internet access, and then they can work. Some of your kids even could turn on offline access and be able to access their files without having to have internet, so that's kind of nice too. So those are the terms. Any questions about those? Does that kind of make sense for those of you new to this? I know it's late, and we've had lunch. And the last one that I didn't mention is Google Chrome, which is Chrome's browser. There's lots of benefits to using Chrome over Internet Explorer, or now I think they call it Edge or Firefox. If you're doing anything Google related, it's best to do it in Chrome because it's going to function better because that is Google's browser. And the benefit to that is anything that I bookmark or any of the extensions that I add to my Chrome browser, wherever I go, if I log into the browser, it all goes with me. So this is kind of important for you to note. I don't know if you can see it. Way at the top, there's a square, a gray square, this gray square up here that I hover over is turning blue. That says Deborah. Okay, so that's my login. So when I opened up Chrome, I logged in as Deborah, and then anytime I bookmark something, it stays on my profile. So if I were to come here and not have my laptop, which I don't think, it is plugged in. I was going to say, it might die in a minute anyway, and I have to use something else. But wherever I go, as long as I log into the browser, all my stuff goes with me. So all my bookmarks will go with me. I don't have to say, what was that site? I bookmarked it at school on my desktop, and now I don't know what it is. It will all go with you. And all these little buttons that you see up here are all extensions that we've installed, and those all go with me. So I no longer have to be tied to one machine. I can log in on any of your machines that you have right now in front of me and get all of my stuff, which is really nice. The other thing I want to show you about Chrome, about the browser itself, is I can do something called incognito window. So if I click on the three dots or the three lines over in the right-hand corner, some people call those hot dog hamburgers, so you might hear those terms. But I have the ability to go to a new incognito window. Now, that is blocked for your kids at school. They cannot do that. I don't know if it's blocked for teachers. I don't recall when we train together, but new incognito window would be good if you go somewhere like the public library and you want to log into your drive and pull something up. If you forget to log out, then being on an incognito window, once you close it, it's going to log you out. You don't have to worry about somebody else coming back in and seeing your stuff, and it's not capturing your history. So when I first first heard about it, I thought, well, why would you want that? That's only for people who are doing things on the internet they're not supposed to be doing. Okay, but there are reasons to use incognito windows. So if you're going to do anything on a computer outside of your own that deals with banking or financial or shopping, you want to do that in incognito so that it's not saving that information on a public computer somewhere. Does that make sense? So it's not just for the bad guys looking at things they're not supposed to be. And plus, it's also good for me if I forget to sign out. When I close that window, I'm signing out. All right, let's see. So Chrome browser, we talked about some of those things. There are a lot of things you can do in the Chrome browser that you can't do in any other browser. For instance, I don't know about you, but when I teach and I say, okay, you've got 10 minutes to work on this, and I don't set a timer, well, then I'm in trouble because 10 minutes later, they're still working. 20 minutes later, they might still be working on it. I'm like, oh, 5 more minutes and then another 10 minutes. But in my Chrome browser at the top, I can just say set a timer for however long I want to set it for, 10 minutes. And press enter, and it's going to start a timer and start counting down. And then that timer will go off when that 10 minutes is up. And I can put it in full screen projection so the kids know exactly how much time they have left to work on something. And that's just simply by typing in the browser. And I don't even think you have to type set a timer. I think you can just do timer, 10 minutes, and it will go. So that address bar at the top of your browser is not just for typing in addresses. It also does a lot of different things. So you could type in a math problem. So I could type in up here 2 plus 2 and equals. And it already is giving me the answer right underneath my browser. But when I hit enter, then it will give me the answer, and it will give me a full calculator. So there's lots of things that you can do in that address bar. And I have put those in your handout where it says searching with the Omnibox. That link right there will open up a whole new document and tell you all of those different kinds of things that you can do. Earlier we had a session on Chrome extensions. And so Chrome extensions are little things you can add to your browser to make it do something that it doesn't do already. For instance, I can use one called Google Tone, and when I click on it, I had the volume turned down, sorry. Oh, maybe the speakers aren't on. I muted myself. When I click on it, it'll play a noise, and like that. And if your kids have that on their Chromebooks, or any of you had that installed on your laptop, up would pop a little window that says, Dad is trying to share something with you. And when you clicked on that window, it would go right to that same page on the internet where I was. So it's a nice way of getting things easily out to your kids. Well, in the browser, you can't do that by itself. But if you add an extension, you can do that. And there are good extensions. There are goofy extensions. There are some that are just silly and fun. But then there are other things that actually make your browser function a lot better. So for instance, you guys have been seeing all these short URLs. So like goo.gl, whatever. Well, whatever page I'm on the internet, if I click on my Google link shortener, my extension, then it will come up with a short link. And I can copy that and paste it in somewhere to another website, or just share that with you. Your kids can scan a QR code, that kind of thing. All right, so Chromebooks. Let me hold this. You guys asked about Chromebooks. Any questions so far? So this is telling you about...
This is a laptop. This is a computer. This has the web. That's weird. Okay, so it's the web. There are no programs. So there's nothing to start up. Then how do I do stuff? So no rolling hills of green. Can I use it anywhere? On a unicycle? My calendars, emails, documents. Everything can be saved to the web. That's crazy. So I can throw this thing into a river, and I won't lose my stuff. It doesn't need virus protection. What about annoying updates? Or patches? Or patches for the patches? So it gets better in real time. I wonder if people are ready for this. It's kind of a new thought.
If your school were going to buy laptops for the students. The Chromebooks have a hard drive inside of them, but they're not very large. So when I say not very large, they're like 8 to 16 gigs. But the operating system, the thing that runs the Chromebook, is not on that hard drive. That hard drive is used for when they take screenshots or things of that nature. So it doesn't boot up the computer. So you can, when you get that Chromebook card in your classroom, you can open up a Chromebook, hit the power button, you are online in 8 seconds. Okay, so that's pretty fast. If we were to shut down my laptop, boot it back up, it would take a lot longer than 8 seconds to boot up. So it's a nice thing. It's going to be quick and easy for you to pull them out and kids get on. One kid logs off, give it to the other one, and they're good to go. So I won't see your things if you log off of the Chromebook, and when I log off and you sign back on, you don't see my stuff. So it's a really nice way to do it. And you guys have the Dell Chromebooks, which are actually my favorite, and they have this little thing called an activity light. So I don't even see Chromebook in here. But on the back of the actual laptop itself, there's a little LED light. And that LED light will light up using something called the activity light. And so your kids will know where that is, or you can have them just search for activity light on their Chromebook. And it pops up and looks just like the image you see on the screen. It has a blue hand, a red question mark, and the yellow exclamation mark. When they click on one of those, that light on the back of their Chromebook is going to light up that color. So you can have them working on all of their things, whatever assignment it is that they're working on, and you can say, all right, if you have a question as you're working, just hit your red activity light. You will see that light up, and you will know which kid to go over and assist instead of them saying, miss, or come help me, okay? Or you can use that in playing a game when you're asking questions. If you know the answer to this, hit your blue activity light. And so you can look and see from the backside of their computers if they're understanding or getting the concepts based on those lights, and you're not having to disrupt the whole class. So that's a pretty cool thing. I've included here some tips and things about your Chromebook that you should know. So some tips on using the Chromebook, things to keep in mind if you want to do a scavenger hunt or a bingo game with them, then all of that is there for you. But I will tell you the biggest thing with your Chromebooks, when you see them, and it's a whole training file here for you. Let me scoot down. I have given you like trackpad gestures, things you can do and not do on the Chromebook. So just we're really used to using our fingers on our touch screens, our devices. Your trackpad is going to work that same way. So if you're used to swiping with 3 fingers or 4 fingers, you can do that on the trackpad of your Chromebook. So as kids are working and you have a guess that somebody else has something else open on their trackpad or on their Chromebook, but they're so quick at switching when you start walking towards them, you can just have them swipe down with 3 fingers and it's going to show you everything that's open on that Chromebook. Mm-hmm. down for me, close that game. Swipe down for me, close that. Okay. And then when you swipe back up, it goes back into whatever application they were working on. Okay. So I've included in here those kinds of things. The biggest thing about your Chromebook that will be different from anything that you are used to seeing is on the top row of the Chromebook are different keys. So it's not like the F keys that we have on a laptop. There'll be different keys up there. One is that overview mode. So I think it's like the sixth button has the little square with the two lines next to it. It will do the same thing as swiping down. But also if you use that and the Alt key, you can take a screenshot of what's going on that screen. So if at any point in time you see something on a kid's screen that shouldn't be there, then you can screenshot that and it will be stored on that Chromebook, or the Google folks, your admin folks, can have it sent directly to their drive. So it's just kind of nice to know that you have that capability. Now what I will tell you about your Chromebooks is your district administrators can control so much more with your Google Apps than you guys can with your personal accounts. Okay? So they can control, and I don't even remember all of the settings that we set on those Chromebooks, but they could say that no one else besides a Lawton PS login can log into the Chromebook. So if they were to take them home, mom can log in with a personal account if she wanted to. Okay, so they have lots of controls and things that they can set up. So they can say the elementary kids, you guys can share your stuff, but only with Lawton public school people. In high school, you guys can share stuff with anyone else. So if you are going to a different district or working in a different district, you can share with other people. So that's kind of nice that you have those controls. The other thing, so this looks like your key, is kind of what your keyboard looks like here. One thing when you see a Chromebook that's going to look very different to you is it does not have a caps lock key. Instead of a caps lock key on the Chromebook, it has a search icon. So it looks like a little magnifying glass. John, you have your Chromebook here, right? Can we pass it around just for them to look at the keyboard? His is not a Dell Chromebook, so it will be a little bit different in functionality, but the keyboard is also the same. So that confuses people every so often about that caps lock key. But you can hold down the Alt key and you can bring that caps lock back. So I've put that here for you in case you happen to be interested. Most everything else on your Chromebook it's just the same. It's just not storing it to the actual computer. It's saving everything in the Google Drive. What Chromebook questions do you have? Or do you have? Yes.
So I don't even have a visual in my brain what a Chromebook looks like. And so I have used iPad before, and I really like to use like the
iMovie trailers, is that what you're saying? Right. There's not a program that comes already pre-installed on the Chromebooks that has that. So what you would do is you would go to the Chrome Web Store. So just like for your iPads, you go to the iTunes Store. There's a Chrome Store, and you could search for movie trailers, or you could search for whatever it is you're wanting them to do, and then you could add that application or that extension to your Chrome, and then it's tied to your browser. So wherever you're logged in, you have access to that. So one program a lot of schools use to do video stuff is called WeVideo, W-E Video, and I can pull it up in the Chrome Store real quick so you can see what it looks like. Chrome Store. WeVideo. There's a free version and a paid version. And it looks like this. Okay. I think the green screen feature in WeVideo is a part of the paid, is that right? iPad, you would install iMovie, if it was an already there. Well, you would click Add to Chrome and install that. Now, for you in your district, as a teacher, you have full access to the store. So you can go in, you can look, you can install applications, you can install extensions, but your kids don't have that capability. So if you decide, ooh, I like this Wii video, I can do movie trailers in that, then you would talk to your library media specialist, or you would talk to AJ here in your district, and they can push it out to the kids. Because there are a lot of things in the app store that kids can use to get around other things, and other things in the app store that, not necessarily bad, but waste of time versus educational use. And so kids in a lot of districts don't have that capability. But if you find something you like and you want your kids to use it, then you just ask your library media or AJ, and they will push it out so your kids will automatically have it. Okay, and so we train them how to do that. So you see the Chromebook looks just like a laptop, right? Just a few different little keys, and John has a few stickers on the back of it. Yes, ma'am.
If I have something like a PowerPoint that I want to put in my Google Classroom, how would I do that?
Okay, to put into Google Classroom or into your Google Drive? Okay, either way. So you guys have already probably created a ton of stuff in Microsoft, right? Because that's what you had. There's no need to recreate anything. Okay. So let me show you my Drive. Remember we said Drive is a place, oh there it is. Drive is a place where you store all of your stuff. So this is my Drive. Over on the left, it says my Drive, and I have a ton of folders. Okay, so here's a folder with pictures, here's a folder with my company trainings, Google Camp, conference presentations, blah, blah, blah. Okay, it's all there, just like you would store things in my document. So if you have a PowerPoint, you don't want to recreate it. All you have to do is drag it from wherever it is in your My Documents or whatever into your Google Drive. So I'm going to move this over a little bit so you guys can see. And here's a PowerPoint that I have on my desktop. Okay, you guys can't see because it's so little. But I'm just going to click on it and I'm going to drag it over here, and I'm hovering over my folder that says Deb Atchison Trains. Or I can just put it in the conference presentations or wherever I want to put it. As soon as I let go, it's going to start uploading that to my Drive. So you can see over on the right, it's uploading it. It has the orange key, so it still is going to keep it in PowerPoint format. And it'll tell me here in a second when it's done. It's done. I can click on it and it will go right to that presentation. So it's going to open up. This is a Z space PowerPoint. It'll open it up and I can run it just as normal. Okay. Now, with Office files, when you drag them to your Google Drive, unless you convert them to a Google file, which you can tell it to do automatically, it's going to stay an Office file, and all you can do without an extension is just view it. So if I wanted to edit this PowerPoint, I would need to open it as a Google file to be able to edit it. So let me show you how to do that. So it's just in view only mode. If you hover over it, you see at the left there's the orange P up here, you can kind of see. It says it's a PowerPoint file. In the middle at the top it says open with, and I can click on Google Slides, and it will convert it to a Google Slides presentation now, and I can edit it, I can delete things, I can put in new things, and therefore I'm not having to recreate that presentation. You guys don't have time to recreate all of this work that you've done before, but now it's in here, it's in Google Slides, I can do anything in here that I would do in PowerPoint. So I can add a new slide, I can delete slides, I can add text, pictures, all of that kind of stuff. Okay. Now let me go back to my Drive and show you what has happened. I think I put that in my trainings folder. if you're starting brand new, I would say I start everything in Google Docs now. I used to do everything Office, and I was a huge Office person. I did Office trainings. I was Office certified. But having it in my Google Drive is so convenient. So I start now everything in Google Drive. I started as a Google Slide instead of going to PowerPoint to start brand new. Unless there are super advanced things I want to do that I can't do in Google Slides.
Is everyone able to view this?
Yes, so everyone can view your Google Slides presentation. They don't have to have anything extra other than an internet connection if you're watching it live and the Chrome browser. Whereas if you have a PowerPoint and you share with people, they need to have PowerPoint to be able to see it. Okay, so that's a good question. If you look back now in the drive, you see this is where I moved over the PowerPoint. Oops, let me scroll back down. So you can see here's the PowerPoint file. I know it's a PowerPoint file because it has the P. Okay. The one right beneath it is the same title, Introduction to ZSpace. It now has the Google Slide icon. So when we open it with Google Slides, it just converts it, but it keeps our PowerPoint original. So if you need to go back and show it in PowerPoint, you can go back and show it in PowerPoint. That makes sense? So everything you have stored in My Documents, you can click on it and drag it over to Google Drive, and then it's all stored in the cloud. And so when you go home, you don't have to lug a laptop home. If you have a computer at home, you can just log into your drive at home and work on it. When you come back to school, here's your laptop. You log in. It's exactly everything you added to it the night before. So the beautiful thing is you don't have to save. It saves automatically. So if power goes out, your kids don't have an excuse, oh, I forgot to save. Well, guess what? It's saved automatically for you. So that's really nice. There's no limit on your school accounts. So your personal accounts will be limited to about 15 to 30 gigs, but your school account, unlimited. Now, I would say I would not go home and take all of your My Documents and drag it all over at one time because it will take a long time to copy it over. So you might want to do a few folders at a time. Or that lesson plan folder you might want to do by itself, and all the other folders, drag them over together. Because it will take a little bit of time. I think when I trained the IT folks here, at the beginning, someone drugged their My Documents over and it said it was going to take like 24 hours. So just do a few at a time, it'll go much faster. And then the benefit to this is I can access it anywhere. So I can put the Google Drive app on my phone and I can pull it up from here. So if I really needed to present my keynote this morning from my phone, I could have done that because I have it saved in my Google Drive. All right, what was the other, was there another question around that? So the good thing about using Chrome and using Google Drive, it's going to be the same for you as an experience on either your Dell computer, your Surface, your HP, whatever you have, Google Apps, or G Suite, all works the same way. So even though your students have a Chromebook and you have a Surface, or they have a Chromebook and you have HP, it's still going to function the same way. So it's nothing different as far as that file itself goes. Now, here's the good thing. Because this is a Google document, if you guys wanted a copy of this, you know, we all took our pictures and wrote down the link at the beginning, but if you are logged into your drive on your laptop, then you can come over to File, and you can click on Make a Copy. And it's going to ask you, what do you want to call this? And it has the same name as what I named the document. And then beneath it, it says Folder. So if you've organized your drive and you have lots of folders, you can choose which folder you want it to go into. And then when you click on OK, you now have a copy of my file in your Google Drive that's private to you. So one of the teachers earlier said, can I use your file for a training I'm doing next week? Sure. So they went, they made a copy of it. Now they can go in and edit it up and share that file with their participants, and they're not having to start from scratch, which is kind of a nice little thing. So I'm going to cancel that. The other thing, let's see. Those of you who are on laptops, are you in this document where we're talking about? I should be able to tell if I can see. No. So if you are on a laptop and you are in Google Drive, type in this address so you can get to the training file. Actually, you can do it from your devices too. So if you will open up, type that in. I want to show you one of the best features of Google Drive. Google Docs. So the beautiful thing about Google is that we can all be in the same file at the same time, and I can determine what you can do with this file. So I can say, you only get to view this file. You only get to see it. Maybe it's a syllabus I've written and I don't want the kids changing it. Okay? So they only get to view it. But there may be other times where I want us to collaborate and work together on the same document. So I can give you that capability as well. All right, so I'm going to go into that document. And right now it says, anybody that has the link, I don't know if you guys can see that, but anybody who has the link can view this file. But I can change that to say anybody who has the link can edit this file or can comment on this file. And now when I click done, you guys can all be on the same document at the same time. And we can all be changing things. And I don't see that anybody is on this. Were you able, Stacy, to get into the document?
I'm not here.
Yeah, you are. Okay, for some reason, you're seeing all the pictures that Now, Stacy, do me a favor, scroll up to the top and click on that G Suite icon and just delete it. So did you guys see that she deleted the icon at the top?
Yep.
All right, so now that icon is gone. She could delete anything on this page that she wanted to. And normally, and I'm not sure why I'm not seeing it, but normally, here they are. These are all, see all these little squares at the top? Those are all of you who have joined this document. So you guys could do anything you wanted to this document. You could delete stuff, you could add stuff. Now, do I really want you to tear it up? No, but that's probably what your students are going to do, right? If you give them that capability of writing on the document. But here's the thing, when your kids are collaborating together on group projects, they can all be at home, separate places, and still working on the same document at the same time. Which is really nice. So somebody put the G Suite back, which was nice. But here's what I want to show you as a teacher. When you're teaching class and you put kids in group work, you pretty much know that Lou here, he doesn't do anything when he works in the group. Everybody else does the work for him, right?
Oh.
I can pick on you because you volunteered today for me. But as a teacher, you know that. But with Google Docs, when your kids are signed into their documents, you know who did what to the document. Yep. So, if I click over here onto the word file, I can click and go down to see revision history, and on the right, the revision history of this document comes back to me. So I can see all the way to the first time it was very created. So I've edited a document, let's see, this goes all the way back to November is when I first started. And I can see right here on November 18th, Casey Irvin made some changes. And as I scroll through the document, anywhere I see orange, that's the change that she made. Or if I look at December 5th, I can see the change made. Or if I look up there at April, I can see all of the changes that have been made. And at any point in time, I can click on one version of that document, and you'll see that big blue button at the top says restore this revision. I can go back to any point in time in the document. So I can see what kids are doing. Now, on ours on the right, it says anonymous users, because you guys are not having to be signed into your account. And when I shared that with you, I said anybody could see it. For your students, they'll be logged into their account. So instead of seeing anonymous squirrel, you'll see Joe Smith. Okay, so you'll be able to know. And once you tell the kids that, they kind of like, Ms. Atchison, no, I didn't do nothing.
Yeah.
I am. And here's another trick for you. If you look at that and there's only been one thing there, and it's a big chunk of text, you can know that, oh, they copied and pasted that right in from somewhere else. Maybe from a friend, maybe from the web. But if there's not a lot of information in that revision history, that's another way for you to kind of know, oh, they didn't do this work themselves. They copied and pasted it all right in there and tell all the secrets. Okay. So at any point in time, I can come back up here to when we started this document, and I can just restore back to that revision if I want to. I'll do that. And then you guys will just refresh and we'll all be back to the document, that icon that was there is back. Anything you guys typed in there is gone. But what's nice, if you'll notice, those of you in this document, just click somewhere in this top part of the document. So you notice here's a purple icon, anonymous grizzly. Here's a red icon, anonymous chameleon. Here's anonymous buffalo. So I can see where you all are in this document at any time. Now, for us, we're anonymous. But again, remember, you'll be seeing your kids' names when they're signed into their address. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so if I've got four people in a group, when I walk by that group, I can see four little things, so all their computers are at work on that document.
Yes, ma'am.
If one is missing, then somebody's playing prodigy.
Are they not in the document? Yes,
they're
absolutely
not in the document.
Yep.
But if they move to something else, they're not in the document.
Yeah. Okay.
Can I try to focus this?
Please do. It's been driving me crazy forever. I don't know that it focuses very much, but yes. And it's hard to see in here, I think, too. They had a special key earlier. They were turning the lights off with. I don't know if that would help. But it is after lunch. I might fall asleep right now. So that's pretty cool. Yes?
Is there like an online...
That's a very good question. So, because I'm leaving today to go back home, you're not going to have me. You do have tech folks on your campuses that have been trained, but there may be times you can't get to them when they have other things. If you look in the top right-hand corner of my Google Doc to the right of the share button, there is a little icon there, and that is called G Suite Training. Oh, so you can see that icon right there. And it has been pushed out to all of you. So you should have, Stacy, do you see it up there? I think we pushed that out. Yes, it is there. So it will be by where your share button is or underneath where you're signing in to get to your Google Apps is. And if I type something in, so if I don't know how to, let's say you forget how to share a document. Here is a video training on how to share a document.
Collaboration features and docs are designed to make document editing amongst multiple people easy, fast, and more efficient.
Okay, so I'm going to turn it down, but basically it's a video. You see it pops up there in the bottom left-hand corner. It's going to walk you through how to share a document. Then what's going to happen, eventually that video is going to get to a point where it says click on the share button, and it's going to wait for you to click on the share button. So it's an interactive video. Instead of just talking or showing you, it's going to wait for you to do something, okay? So it will get to that point where it asks you to do that. Now, that is an extension that has been pushed out to all of your devices. So once you are on Chrome and you are logged in with your Lawton Public Schools Gmail address, then you should see that icon up there. And if you're in Google Docs and you click on it, it's going to be all Docs specific. specific videos. If we go to Google Classroom and we click on that, it's going to be all videos about Google Classroom. So wherever you are, drive, whatever, that little button is pretty much going to be your friend. Because you can search for what you want. Yes, ma'am?
He is logged in his phone, but it's not showing that.
You can't log in, you're gone. No, it's because of the way I shared the documents. Okay, so I shared it. Anyone with the link can view it. So that's why you guys are all coming in anonymously.
No, I mean, it's not showing that.
The circle with the question mark.
Yeah, it's not showing the.
And he is logged into the browser.
I'm logged in. The browser.
He's in.
Okay, so let me tell you about logging into your browser, because that's probably the hardest thing. Notice here now I quit yakking long enough, the video went through, and now see it has this orange click here, so it's waiting. It's waiting for me to go to the next step in that tutorial. Excuse me. All right, so I'm just going to exit that, answer the question that he's talking about over here. This is probably, I would say, the most confusing thing when teachers start with Google Apps, okay? And I'm going to walk over here to kind of point to where it is, since it's you really can't see. So in my Google Doc, right above the share button, you see my Google login. It says devatchison@gmail.com. So that means I am logged into my Google Apps account. So I can go to Drive. I can go to Google Docs, Google Slides, any of those things. Okay? Just because you're logged into your Google Drive does not mean you are also logged into Google Chrome. Okay? So those really are two separate things. Remember, Chrome's the browser, Drive is like a hard drive. So if you look way up here above the share, above all those little dots, there's a teeny tiny gray square up there. And it has my name. It says Deborah. That means I am logged into the Chrome browser. Okay? So because this training thing is an extension that's been pushed out by your district, you have to be logged into the browser at the same time to be able to get it. Now, that extension will not work on your mobile devices. It's only going to work in Chrome on a laptop, PC, Mac, Chromebook. Okay? Extensions don't yet work on our iPads or iPhones. Okay? So once he clicks on that little top square, because his square looks like it was just a tiny square. It didn't say Lou up there. Once he clicks on it and logs into the browser, then he should have that extension should come out from the district being pushed. Okay? So it's really kind of a confusing thing. Because you can get to your Google Drive, but you're still not signed into the browser. So if I go up to the top and I click on Deborah, that square, you see I'm signed in up here. It has my name, it has my Gmail address. Then it also has a couple of other accounts that I've used to sign into the browser. So I could sign in as my training account. Or my WCISD account, I can sign into those. Okay? Or I can click on Manage People, and I can add a new person. So if John wanted to be able to sign into Chrome on my computer, we could add him, he could put his name, pick in an account, a little icon, and then he would be able to log into Chrome and get all of his extensions and all of his school stuff. So it's kind of confusing, so just always look to see, I'm going to cancel this, if at the very top, if in that little square, does it have a little person or does it have a name? And it should have your name tied to it, or you might be in the browser as someone else's account. Yeah, it just has your name and you're still not seeing that extension. You are logged in and you have Lou up there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You refresh just in case.
Yeah.
I'm at the point now where I'm just going to turn the computer off and turn it off.
So if you guys don't see that training extension and you are logged into the browser, so it has your name up there and you know it's your school account, not your personal account, and you're signed into your drive, then check with Megan or one of your IT folks and they'll see what's happened. And once we figure it out over here, we'll tell you. Excuse me, what that is. So that will help. That's also how any of those extensions or applications that you install, so if you install WeVideo and you're logged into your personal account, it's not going to show up on your school account. So you want to make sure you're logged into your school account. Yes, ma'am. You do have school accounts. And here you have the address.
It's your same as your login.
Yeah,
it's just your login.
Same password, same
Thank you. So you can go to that little icon and on Chrome and log in, same thing you do to get onto your computer, and then you'll be into Chrome. And you can always go to drive.google.com and do that same login. Okay? And then you'll get to all of, that's how you're going to get to all of your Google apps. So for me, it's just easiest to go to drive.google.com and log into all my stuff. Okay. All right, good questions. Other questions about any of this that we've already talked about? That's a lot of stuff in a little bit of time, and you guys are hanging in with it. So that's really impressive. Yes, ma'am. You're not in this district.
Right.
Okay. So
I have my name like up there like that, but maybe it's there and I don't know.
Okay, we'll look at it before
yeah.
we leave for sure.
Yeah.
And that Google, that G Suite training, that's been pushed out by the admin here. So what you could do when you go to your school or you go to a different school, then you can say, I really use this, can you push this out? And then they can push that out so that everybody has it. And you're not having to go to the store and install it separately. Kind of like Megan pushes out the apps on the iPad, they can do that same kind of thing on your Chromebook or on just the Chrome browser. I want to refresh your browser, and I'm going to change this back so you guys can only view it. And then that way we know nothing's being torn up. But those of you that are on, even from your mobile devices, you can click on File, Make a Copy, and then you have a copy of this in your Google Drive. So when you click on Google Drive, it should be there for you. Right, do you guys need a stand-up break? Are you okay? Yes? All right. So how about we take about 3 or 4 minutes, just a stand-up instruction. Of course, you can. I would not use the main one that comes with your account. Okay, that's the default one. So when you sign in with your Lawton Public Schools account, your main calendar, you just get one. Okay, everything can go on there. What I would do is click on that arrow and choose a new calendar. And I would create that to be Miss Smith's class or whatever it is. And then you can share that calendar with your kids. And they will see just the stuff you put on there. So just do that there. All right, I'm going to go back to the calendar. I'm not going to really create one. The other thing you have on the left is you have other calendars. So you can see I have different calendars that are added here. I even have my mother-in-law's calendar because we need to keep up with her, my husband's calendar. Holidays in Ukraine, because the boys still have family there. We want to make sure we celebrate National Women's Day and call their grandma. So if you look next to other calendars, you can click on Browse Interesting Calendars. And you can choose between any of these calendars to add. And let me see if I can blow that up where you can see. So you can put Christian holidays, Jewish holidays, Muslim, Orthodox, holidays in all these different countries.
So I put the holidays in Ukraine on my calendar so I'd be able to see them. The guys in the group, and maybe girls too. There's also sports calendars. If you want to add the baseball calendar or the rugby calendars, then you can go to those calendars and you can add whichever ones you want. So then now when you look at your main calendar, all of your Major League Baseball games will show up on that calendar.
Pretty cool.
And then there are more. I don't remember what's under more. Oh, if you want to know what day of the year it is, phases of the moon, star dates, week numbers, feel free to add them. And you can always turn them off. So if I go back to my calendar and I don't want to see, because it's getting really junky, I don't want to see maybe other calendars, I just click on them to turn them off. And then they're not in view. Okay? And then if I want to view it again, I just click on it and it turns it back on and I see those dates. And so that's one quick way to know. Plus it's color-coded with what's over on the left. Let's see, what else? They do have a thing, if you click on the gear over on the very right, a thing called labs, which are experimental things that you can add. So you could do any of these things. If you want to see a year view, there's not currently a year view. You can enable that so you can see the whole year at a time. You can put background images, all kinds of fun little things. These are usually things that are in beta. They're just rolling them in, a real feature of the calendar. But that's pretty much really it. Other questions? One thing I forgot to tell you, when I click on a calendar and I'm going to edit this event, you do have the option to click on add a video call. Your students don't have that option. It's been turned off for them. But you can click add a video call. So let's say if I made an appointment with you and we were going to do a Google Hangout to talk about whatever. You would click add video call when it was time for me to connect with you on Google Hangouts. I would just go to my calendar and I would click join video call. And it's already linked. I don't have to set up another meeting or anything like that. And then you and I are using Google Hangouts to talk about it. Which is kind of nice. Your kids don't have that though. Alright, so does that kind of answer some calendar questions? The other things under the other calendars, you can add a friend's calendar. So if you know their email, you can add it there. So whatever that button public schools calendar is, if you know the email of the person who maintains that, or if you know the URL of that calendar, then you can add it by putting in the URL. So if you've opened it up, it's on a web page somewhere, snag that address, paste it in there, and then that Lawton calendar is on top of yours, and you can see it all.
So that's how you sync. You just have to have the URL for the calendar to sync them?
Yeah, you either have to have the URL, or you've got to have the person that created it shares that calendar.
Okay.
All right. So that's calendar. Now let's take a look at forms. I got all kinds of stuff over here. I don't even know. All right, so there's a section called forms. It's a whole new training, so it's a whole different link we can go into. But I want to show you, I won't spend a lot of time because we are running out of time. I want to show you what a Google form looks like. So you would give the kids the URL to the quiz, or you would post it in your Google Classroom. They would click on it, and it would open beautifully. Magically. Perfect.
right now because there are a lot of questions that I said were required and I didn't answer them. But if they would go through, answer them all, and submit, then I am going to have on the back end, they will see their score if I choose to let them see it. But on the back end, I have all of the results of what they typed in. So this is where I can go in and edit the questions. Maybe I don't care about one of the questions, I don't like it, I can edit it, I can delete it. But I also have responses. So I can see all of their responses from, I think the Wi-Fi is getting tired too. Going to show me all in one place. It'll be there eventually. All of the kids' answers. So anytime you need to send something out, maybe a survey out to parents or even quizzing, use a Google form and then everything comes into one place. Even so much as if Megan was going to say, what sessions do you want to go to? She could do that in a Google form and then all your answers go into one place instead of each of you emailing her back and back and back. Yes, sir.
Can they ever use the stylus to write or draw their answer?
They can't. So if they pull up on their mobile devices, they could do that. On their Chromebooks, your Chromebooks are not touched, so they wouldn't be able to do that.
Maybe it switched to my hotspot and not your Wi-Fi and my hotspot.
It did. So let me go back to your Wi-Fi. Anything that can be charted is going to give me a graph. So I can look at this and see, if I scroll down here, where do we get new apps? If I were to look at this, I would think, oh, my class has that concept pretty much mastered. I could move on to something different. So anything that can be graphed will be graphed. But what I like is I can also open up all of these answers into a Google Sheet. So this opens up in spreadsheet format. I can see on the left the date and time when they took this quiz. I can see their score because I had it automatically graded. And then I can see all of their answers all the way across. So I have one thing with all the answers. I don't have to carry home a whole stack of papers to grade. I have one file to go to. And because I told it to automatically grade it, it's giving me their scores right there. Pretty nice. And it will keep adding them up. So I've used this form since January 19th is when I first started with it. And every time someone submits, it just adds it to the next row and the next row of this document. Okay, so that's kind of nice. So when I look back at the form, to turn it into a quiz, there are settings for each form. So I've already said, under the quizzes tab, make this a quiz. And then my options are when I want to release the grades. Do I want to send the grades back automatically right after they finish the quiz? Do I want to say you made a 56 out of 100? Or do I want to wait and send them the results later? And that's really up to you. Okay? You may want to send them right away. You may want to send them later. But under the general settings, you have options of letting them only submit once, or they could submit multiple times. You can allow them to see summary charts if you want. If it's a quiz, I would not do that. And then there are all kinds of other options you have within you. So you can decide on the quizzes if you want them to see the missed questions, the point values, or the correct answers. So most teachers will take off the correct answers because they don't want this class telling the next class, right? But you are in control of all of that. So creating the form is just really simple. You just decide what it is you want to add. And over on the right, you're going to click plus. paragraph, and those are the two questions that they can't automatically grade. You would have to go in and grade those. But then you can add multiple choice check boxes, so there could be more than one answer. Drop downs, you can have a linear scale on a scale of 1 to 5. What did you think about the donuts this morning? Multiple choice grade, which is more kind of like a rubric. And then you can add in date and time. You can also add in over on the right pictures and video. And so a lot of teachers will put in videos and then ask questions about those, or put in pictures of math problems and then ask a question about the math problem itself. Okay, so that's Google Forms. That was the fastest I've ever shown Google Forms. So you got it all right? Easy breezy. No problem. Now, to create a new form, you're probably like, that's really cool. I do want to try that. Where do I go? So when you go back to Drive, so you're logged into your Drive, drive.google.com, over on the left there is a new button. And when you click there, it tells you all the new things you can do. So you can create a new folder if you want to organize your Drive. You can upload your files or upload your folders or just drag them in. And then you see you can create a new doc, a new sheet, a new slide, or if you go to More, that's where you're going to find forms. So new, more forms, and then you can just create the form and turn it into a quiz. That was fast. All right, so y'all got it, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're going to all go home and create forms today. All right, the next, and I've got to be logged into a school account. So as a parent or as a personal user, in fact, actually now, I think they have just added you can log into Classroom with personal accounts. But before it had to be tied to a school account, so I'm logging into my school account. You guys would log in, obviously, with your Lawton school account. And then the first time you ever go to Google Classroom, it's going to ask you, are you a teacher or a student? Always pick teacher, because that's what you are, because that gives you the capability of creating a new class. If you click student, you can join classes, but you will not be able to create your own, unless Megan and them have to do something on the background to change that. Okay. Now, here's what a Google Classroom looks like. Or actually, I just created a new one, so you see it's very, very easy. At the top, I'm going to click on the plus sign, and create a class. I'm going to call this class the week later. I can put a section and a subject if I want to, but I can leave some blank. And I'm going to click on create. And that gives me a Google Classroom. So here it is. It picks those pretty blue colors up there for me. But if I don't like them, on the right, I can click on select theme. And I can choose any of these themes that might be more fitting to what my classroom is about. If I'm science or arts or music or whatever. So I can pick a new theme and then it's going to change that. Now, your stream is where everything in your classroom happens. So right now it's a place for you to put a welcome message. You can put your assignments, your announcements, you can post questions. If we click on the blue plus in the bottom right-hand corner, that these are the things I can add. So I can add an announcement, I can add an assignment. The only difference between those two is an assignment means they're going to turn something in. Announcement looks the same, they just don't have anything to turn in. I can add a question, and I can reuse a post. So I'm just going to show you how easy it is to add an assignment. So the first thing I'm going to do is give it a title. So what am I talking about here? What are we studying? If there are any instructions, I can type them here. So maybe you will say, open up the Google Doc and answer it, and don't forget to turn it back in. Now, recently they came out with a new option of being able to select students. students. So we used to not have this capability of being able to choose. Oh, I don't have any students in this class because I just created it. That's why. So I can take this check of all students off, and maybe I have a group of students I want to have an assignment, and this group of students gets a modified assignment. So I can choose the ones that get this assignment as long as they're already in my classroom. And I could also choose to post this to more than one class. So maybe I wanted to show up in my sample classes as well, and I don't have to go do that 30 different times for each class. Then we're going to give it a due date if you choose. If you don't want a due date, that is fine. But if you choose a due date, it's going to go onto that calendar that Google Classroom is already creating for you, which makes it really nice. Now, what's going to happen next is you can give this assignment a topic. So I could create a topic that says week two, or I could create a topic that is about whatever the unit of study that we're doing. Because as you start posting things in Google Classroom, it's just one long strand of information. So at first, it's easy to find what you're looking for. But by this time of the year, that's a lot of stuff. So kids can search by topic over on the left and see all of the topics that deal with the 5th, 6th weeks, or the 6th, 9th weeks, or whatever you go by here. Now the important part is down here at the bottom, these are the things you can attach. So you can attach a PDF to this assignment, you can attach a Google Drive file, a YouTube video, or just a link. So if I click on Google Drive, then I can go to my Google Drive and I can find anything I might have created in here. And I'm going to go to my drive because some of the stuff is shared. So this is the assignment I want. So I find my Google Doc. Here's class notes. That's the assignment. Now, the really, really most important thing is once you attach a Google Drive file, you have to determine what you want those kids to do with it. So you have three options. The first one, I think, says to let them view the file. Students can view the file. So this would be like a syllabus or a unit plan of study that you don't want them editing. Right? They can all see it, no big deal. They can't do anything to it. They can't change it. They can't edit it. The second thing says students can edit the file. That means it's going to be like it was earlier when I gave you guys editing rights on my document. You guys could change things up, and it's only one copy of the document, but we're all working on the same one. So if you want it to be a collaborative assignment, that's what you would pick. But if it's an assignment that you want each kid to turn in, you're going to choose the last option, which is make a copy for each student. Then it's going to take this class notes file, it's going to make a copy, it's going to give it to each one of the kids in your class, and it's going to have class notes / John Atchison, or whatever each kid's name is. So they're going to get their very own copy. I can choose to schedule this later, so if you're working over the weekend and you want to schedule this to go out on Monday, you can. You can save it as a draft, or you can just click on assign, and it is assigned immediately to the students in your classroom. So they will get probably an email notification that says, hey, the teacher gave you this new assignment, and they will have it in their Google Classroom. So when they would log into Google Classroom, click on your class, and there it is. And they would open it up. And over here, you see, right now, I don't have any kids in this class, so let me go to one that does, so you can see what that looks like. I want this state. This is one I believe has students in it.
Can you put, like, a Quizlet link in there?
Yes, you can. You can put Quizlet link. That's not, for whatever reason, I am not doing Quizlet.
You're not in your name.
Oh, there we go. Zoomed in. So you can see on some assignments here, there's 31 kids in this class that have not completed this assignment. seven that have not. Okay? So as a teacher, I always know who just turns that back in and who has it. Now, you won't get notification if you put in a Quizlet link that they finished the Quizlet. You'll just, only if it's something they're having to turn back in. But when I click on my done results, here's all of my kids' work. So I can open up Elaine's file, and I can see everything that she added to the file. Okay, so red rum. That's her summertime plan. All right, she's being honest, right? Now, for your kids, what they see when they go into Google Docs and they click on that class notes or the summertime fun activity, and it opens up to the top by the blue share button, they're going to have a blue button that says turn in. So they type in all their information, they click on turn in, and it's submitted to Google Classrooms. And then that number back here, this number goes up because somebody turns that in. That's kind of the mechanics of Google Classroom, and that's really as hard as it gets. What you're going to do when you create your Google Classroom is you're going to invite your kids to join that class. So they're going to go to classroom.google.com. They're going to click on the student if it's their first time. They're going to sign in with their Lawton Public School, and they have accounts just like you guys do. And then they are going to go, if I go back over here to home. I know that's not thunder out there, I'm hearing. Is it? Oh, yeah. Okay, thanks. I grew up close to Fort Hood, Texas, and so, yeah, now that makes perfect sense. No, whereas we clicked on the plus and we clicked create a class, they're going to click on the plus and they're going to click on join class. And the way they're going to join class, you're going to click on the Students tab, and then on the Student tab, there is a class code. So it'll be like a six-digit code over there on the left. They'll click plus, join class, they'll type in your code, and then all of a sudden, you'll see them popping in to adding into your classroom. One of the newer features gives us the ability to invite guardians. So if you wanted to go into Elaine's account, you could invite her guardian. So some of the voice teachers have invited me as the voice guardian. Then I got an email that said, would you like notifications from Google Classroom? I said, oh, yes, I do. And I chose, I want a daily notification. Come on, I wouldn't have to worry about he does his work. Dimitri, maybe I have to worry a little bit more. So every day at the end of the day, I get an email from Google Classroom that says, here's everything that's happened in their Google Classroom. I don't see the actual assignment, like the file they attached, but I see what it asked for, and I see when they didn't turn it in. If it's past due, then it says, John did not turn in this file. So the first thing I ask him when he comes in is, why did you not do that file in Google Classroom? Right? So it helps parents kind of help you if you've got parents that will encourage their kids to get their work. But you don't have to do that, but it's an option. But then parents can always opt out and say, no, I don't want them. The About page gives you the opportunity to talk about your classroom. So maybe that's where you would put your syllabus, anything that you want kids to refer back to all the time, you would go there. And then you also see the calendar options. So you can view it, the calendar in Classroom, or you can view it in Google Calendar. And then it will put your class calendar on your Google Calendar like what we just did. That's a lot of stuff in a short amount of time. Is it overwhelming? No. It feels overwhelming. So, yes, that tutorial, because look up here, you've got this tutorial right here. It will help you. So when I on that. It's all going to be about Google Classroom. Okay. How does the grading work? Good question. So when I go to students, I can see their work. Assignments. If I put in a quiz, it's going to automatically grade it. If not, I can, as I, let's see where I want to put this. I think that's good. So when I see the kids' work over here to the right, there's a space for me to put the grade. So I can go next to Jody and I say, oh, Jody did a great job. She gets a 100. Okay, and I put my grades all in here. Now here's the problem. This does not export out to your grade book. Okay? It's not tied to your grade book. So it's like almost duplicate effort. But it will export your grades out to a spreadsheet or to a CSV file. So if your gradebook will take an import, which I don't know if it will or not, an import of grades on a spreadsheet, then you can import them into your gradebook. So what a lot of teachers do is they open up their Google Classroom and they move it over here to the side and they open up their gradebook over here and then just type in from there. You would do that when you're creating the form. Okay. So if you create a form, you say you want to make it a quiz, it gives you a space for you to tell it what the right answer is, then it will automatically grade it for you, and it will put that grade here. All right, other questions?
If I was assigning like a group project, or like, would you, I'm assuming you'd go in there and find certain students and then give them one file and find another person. Is that how you'd have to do that?
That is exactly how you would have to do that. So here I have a class with students now. So if I click on create assignment, instead of all students, now I can click, okay, I want these four people to be in this one group and I would assign them that document. Then I would attach another assignment with this group and give them a different document if they were getting it.
Could you repost and change the student? And could you use the repost?
Yes, so you could, yes. Yes, that's a very good question. Use the repost on that plus and then change who you're posting it to. It would be a great option.
Once you get comfortable with this too, like I know the quizzes will do multiple choice and drop in those, but if you want short answers, like, it has a message that you can use for the word. But then once you get used to this, then you can ask if they get a message or look it up or something. But that doesn't have that. I know the chemistry teacher in my school is using it. You have to type this in exactly or it's not right. So,
and that's what we used to have to use before Google added the quiz feature to forms. You used to have to use something else to grade it for you. Now at least on multiple choice, check boxes, true, false, those kinds of things, it'll grade for it, which is nice. But if you want to do more advanced grading, then what Stacy's talking about is the route. All right, so let me encourage you, because I threw a lot of stuff at you. This would normally be 2 days of training, what we did here in 7 hours. So at least you kind of have an overview. Don't let it overwhelm you. Start with one thing, and if you can sign into your browser and you can get to your drive, call it an accomplishment, okay? When you get comfortable with that, then venture out. Maybe I want to create a form. Maybe I want to start Google Classroom with one class, and let's just kind of see how it went. So you've got some teachers here in your district that are using it and using it quite a bit. That would be willing to help you. I had one teacher, and I just drew a blank on her name. She came up to me earlier today. She follows me on Twitter, so I've known her in social media a long time. But she said she has her classroom almost paperless now. And she told the kids, all right, we're going to learn this together. Here's classroom. I need you to help me run this. We're going to figure it out.
And she said they love it because they kind of have a little bit of the power of, we're going to figure it out together. And it seems to be doing really well. So you've got folks in your group here, so lean on them and they will help you.
The question, too, a lot of times you can always ask a question. They answer almost immediately. I've asked questions on that form for something, and I'll go do something for a teacher and I'll come back and I've already got an answer. But they're really pretty quick on answering.
Oh, through the questions here? All right, well, let me show you where that is, because that's a good idea. So down here on the bottom, there's a little question mark. You can get help. Okay, so you can go to their help classes and get help, or you can ask a question of what Stacy's talking about and email them your questions. I can't figure this out. I know someone told me, how do I do it? The other thing I would encourage you to do as you start using these tools is send them feedback. Google Classroom is the only product that's ever been designed by Google strictly for schools. Everything else has been designed by business and then adapted to school. So they don't always know what we need as teachers. So when you think there's something Classroom should do that it doesn't, send them feedback, because that's how we've gotten a lot of the new features, like the Guardian emails, adding another teacher to your class, those kinds of things. Good comment. All right. You guys look tired. You are to be commended for being here all day long. I'm impressed. Very good. All right, I'll stay around. If you have other questions, I'll be happy to answer.